And so with this, without any further ado, we have a very interesting speaker, and I'm going to take the prerogative myself of introducing Lew Jennings, if you would, please.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks again for coming. I haven't met Jack. He's an artilleryman, and you know the motto of the artillery, they lend dignity to the battlefield. What would otherwise be a brawl? Thank you, Jack. Good morning. We're going to talk about the Battle of Hamburger Hill this morning. How many rotor heads are in the audience? We got them outnumbered, fellas. Just like we wanted. Thank you, Felipe, for the lights. May 1969, May 10th through the 20th. How many people been to Vietnam? Quite a few of us, quite a few of us haven't. It's 14,608 miles that way across the Pacific. Over there in Southeast Asia, surrounded by China in the north, Laos and Cambodia in the west, sits right on the South China Sea. This is what it looked like at the end of 1954, when the French Indochina War was over. It was separated into two countries as we knew, North Vietnam, South Vietnam, North Vietnam being communist. This is the Ho Chi Minh Trail. It was a series of roads, trails, and a conduit for the North Vietnamese to bring down their supplies, personnel, and equipment from North Vietnam. And they just bypassed us around the DMZ and would come in from the west. Back in 1968, a year earlier, was the Tet Offensive, when Ho Chi Minh and his compadres gathered 70,000 soldiers and attacked over 100 cities and hamlets throughout Vietnam. Very strategic situation. This is a picture from the Battle of Hue, the ancient city up north. That lasted for over a month. The Marine Corps finally won that one. But that introduced Americans at home, saw this on television, and it was our first huge battle. We won it. We won it overwhelmingly, but it gave a huge propaganda machine for the North Vietnamese to say, hey, you're not going to fool with us without us fighting back. And a famous quote from Walter Cronkite, he was over there, took a look at the situation, saw what was happening at during the Tet Offensive. And then Quezon, and the siege of Quezon was going on at the same time, and he concluded that we were in a stalemate situation and the only thing we could do was negotiate diplomatically to end it. That's when President Johnson said, if I've lost Walter Cronkite, I've lost the country. And Johnson finally became so distraught that he made that major announcement where he wasn't going to run for office anymore. Somebody else could do it instead of him. And of course, that person was Richard Nixon. Came on board, familiar faces there, including Alexander Haig, who at that time was a young colonel and was an assistant to the secretary and to the national security people. What was his name? I forgot. Yeah, how could you forget that? Things also changed in Vietnam. General Westmoreland had been there forever, and now he was brought back to the U.S. as the U.S. Army Chief of Staff, and in his place, Creighton Abrams came on board to be able to conduct a new style of warfare. We were still, when Johnson decided not to run for office, he kind of gave an olive branch to the North Vietnamese and he stopped bombing up north. The problem was, as Ho Chi Minh said, wow, you're not going to bomb us, I can move everything down south. And so we were getting flooded with NVA forces from the north. And this was a situation we were faced in 1969. One of the primary avenues that they came in was the Ashaw Valley, way, way up in the north, about 30 miles below the DMZ, and out in the mountains to the west, right on the border with Laos. A year earlier, the 1st Cavalry had conducted a huge operation there to try to clean up and get them out of the Ashaw Valley. Met with a lot of success, also shot down a lot of helicopters in the process. And then the 9th Marines, just a month before Hamburger Hill, had conducted an operation called Dewey Canyon and had just discovered huge amounts of equipment, weapons, even tracked vehicles and trucks. That was a month prior. Now, we're in April of 1969, just days before the start of the operation. This is looking at the Ashaw Valley from the north to the south. So if we're looking at this, the DMZ is behind our backs about 30 miles. The DMZ in the Quezon Plain is right behind us. Just off to the right of the picture, just 2 miles, 2 to 3 miles, is the Laotian border. To the left of the photo is the ridgeline and the low mountains and then the coastal plains where the city of Hue, the coastal villages, and Camp Eagle, Camp Evans, and some of the other army facilities are. We're only a short distance from the Ashaw Valley. On 25 April, returning fast movers had still weapons and ordnance on board from their trip to North Vietnam, and a FAC, a forward air controller, put them on that left ridge line and said, why don't you drop your bombs here? They dropped their bombs and huge secondary explosions. So the FAC relayed that information up to high headquarters and said, man, there's something down in there on that ridge line, and we've got huge secondaries. And that was sent to the 101st Airborne Division. Now the 101st had reluctantly traded in their parachutes for helicopters. We had almost 400 in the division. And it was our turn to go in and investigate why we had so many secondary explosions. So the next day, on the 26th, we put in a couple of small platoons of infantry from our air cavalry units, my unit, Alpha Troop, 2nd and 17th Air Cavalry, and my sister unit, Charlie Troop. They immediately got into contact as they were trying to climb up and take that ridge line, and they got overwhelmed. What they didn't know was that this was a huge supply base, even had an underground hospital on that left ridge line, and belonged to the 6th North Vietnamese Regiment headquarters. They were overwhelmed and called for help, and of course the 101st responded, we've got a lot of troops and a lot of helicopters, so we sent in troops aboard Bravo Company 158. I don't know if you can see this very well, but those are, it's not a good picture. Got crashed helicopters. This was their first approach into the LZ. It was a two-ship landing zone. And this was the Ghost Riders from the 158th. Maurice Daugherty was the commanding officer, a major. He got shot down in the first helicopter. His operations officer got killed. He got shot in the back. The second helicopter came in and crashed. Now we've got two helicopters on the ground. We've got wounded, we've got dead, we've got infantry, and we've got the air crews. And then the third helicopter comes in, and that's flown by a guy named Bill Parsons, a young warrant officer. And as he's coming down on his approach to the landing zone, his hydraulics get shot out. In a Huey, when you lose your hydraulics, your controls turn to concrete. You actually have hardly any movement at all. And all he could do was just ride the helicopter right down to the ground. And when you know, it came down, got into ground effect, and actually touched down pretty good. But then it started to lean backwards and fall backwards off the cliff. So he ordered everybody out of the helicopter to run around to the front and stand on the skids. This is while they're getting shot at. So you got infantry plus air crew standing on the front skid to keep the helicopter from falling back down the side of the mountain, while other guys go behind the helicopter and prop up the tail with logs. And then O.B. Carlson, the oldest of the crew chiefs, runs over to his crashed helicopter, removes the reservoir out of that helicopter in a case of hydraulic fluid, comes over and repairs this helicopter, all while they're under fire. And the person taking the pictures is Pat Lyman, and he was another crew chief that's covering them with his rifle and taking pictures with his little Instamatic camera at the same time. Can you believe that? He recently retired as a captain with Southwest Airlines. Anyways, they got the helicopter, the hydraulics working again, and then Bill took all the wounded that he could, the seriously wounded, and flew out with this helicopter, so because he's blocking the LZ, so more helicopters could come in. The next helicopter coming in, that's Elton Searcy. That's one of the air crews. Not everybody could get on Bill's helicopter, nor did they want to, because they didn't have enough people in the LZ to protect themselves. So helicopter crews, those that weren't wounded, stayed in the landing zone and took the machine guns off the crashed helicopters and formed a perimeter security with that. Elton Searcy's one of the pilots, and he's signaling in the next helicopter. He gets killed shortly after this photo was taken. The enemy tracked him down and shot him with a rocket-propelled grenade. 2 days of battle ensued, and the hill was finally taken, and we built out a fire base on that hill, and that you see a Chinook coming in and loading off equipment, ammunition, water, and howitzer cannons. 10 days later, it's my turn. I've been training with the unit for a month. I was down south with the 7th of the 1st Cavalry. I'm by then a qualified aircraft commander, and we've come up to train this unit. It's my first mission into the Ashaw. And I'm gonna come in from the south and fly up here to the north. That was what I looked like back then, young and fierce. I get the mission, and I'm flying my Cobra gunship. This is the Cobra gunship. The pilot sits in the back. The co-pilot sits in the front. And this just was coming into the inventory. Started in 1967, but now they're coming in force, and they're replacing these. We didn't have any gunships early on, so we took Hueys and put guns on them and rockets. But you see all the drag that that creates? It couldn't even keep up with the Hueys it was supposed to escort. So Mike Folsey at Bell Helicopter designed this and took the guts, the transmission and engine and drivetrain out of a Huey and then molded a new fuselage around it. It's only 36 inches wide at its widest point, very fast, and can carry a lot of weapons. Those are rocket pods on the left and right. It could carry up to 17-pound high-explosive warheads, which are equivalent to a 105 howitzer cannon round. We typically carried 52 rockets. For the aerial rocket artillery guys, they carried as many as 72. Up front was this turret, had an Immerse electric Gatling gun that fired 2,000 to 4,000 rounds per minute. And a grenade launcher, 40 millimeter grenade launcher, that fired 300 rounds per minute. This is where the co-pilot gunner sits up front, and his real name is Bullet Catcher. He wears about a 20-pound chicken plate at the time, and he gets to sit up front for 2 to 3 months. If he lives, then he gets to be pilot and gets to sit in the back. But he operates the turret with that contraption on the right, which is his gun sight mounted on a pedestal. All that is just honeycomb, aluminum, and quarter-inch plexiglass. So nothing to stop a BB from coming through the front window. I was married up with a guy named Al Goodspeed, excuse me. Al was a good old Southern boy from Sanford, Florida. We were dear friends. And he was tall and lanky and weighed almost 200 pounds with all his gear on. And of course, he flew the smallest helicopter in the unit. He could hardly fit in it. These are our scout helicopters, the 086. Notice it's shaped like an egg. It had a built-in roll cage, so even if you crashed it at 100 miles an hour, sometimes you were able to survive. These guys flew from 5 feet to about 50 feet max, looking for bad guys, and we lost a lot of them. As a matter of fact, we lost 80% of all our scout helicopters in Vietnam. So he and I are out here. We're going to go over into the Ashaw Valley. We're coming in from the south over that eastern lip. And as we do that, this is how it looks. We're just coming over the crest. That's Hamburger Hill, or what's going to become Hamburger Hill on the left. Tiger Mountain is up there on the right. And that little white strip in the middle is the old French airport, the Alooey Airstrip. We're starting to come down. We're going to get real low. We're looking for bad guys, going back and forth. We go up the whole valley, we get to the end, and we don't find anybody. And it's kind of a big sigh of relief. So I told Al, I said, hey, why don't we do some recon by fire? If we don't have any friendlies in the area, we'll go ahead and shoot it up and see if there's any bad guys hiding there. And so we started shooting at an old 50-gallon drum. And then the next thing I know, he's just hauling butt, going as fast as he can away from me, and he won't answer the radio, and smoke's pouring out of the aircraft. And sure enough, what was waiting for us by the 50-gallon drum were these guys with a 12.7-millimeter anti-aircraft gun, and this is what happened to Al. His rotor blades stopped in mid-air because his transmission froze, had been shot through, all his radios were shot through. His observer, Sergeant John Hayden, 50 caliber, it's a 51 caliber round, it's about that daggone big, had gone through his leg and severed his leg. I landed next to the wreckage, coordinated the rescue while my co-pilot jumped out to help. Al Goodspeed was still alive and actually in pretty good shape, so they ripped the door off the engine and used it as a sled, put John Hayden on there, and then my co-pilot, Mike Tolton, used his .38 caliber pistol and a t-shirt to use as a tourniquet to try to save his life, which we did. We had a Huey come in 2 minutes later, one of our light observation helicopters, Tom Michael. We flew him to the hospital, but he did lose his leg. Our commanding general, Melvin Zace, said, okay, enough is enough. The guys had a lot of trouble on the Eastern Ridge Line. Alpha Troop lost a helicopter. We got all kinds of intelligence that there's all kinds of bad guys out here. Our long-range reconnaissance patrols are seeing 1,000 trucks a night coming down the trail over at Laos. So he gets together with Creighton Abrams and Richard Stillwell, who was the Corps commander, and they decide they're going to do a big operation. And they called it Apache Snow, and we're going to do the largest heliborne operation with U.S. troops of the entire war. We're going to take our hundreds of helicopters, and we're going to take 6 battalions and go out and find bad guys. We're going to use hundreds of Hueys as troop transports, as medical evacuation aircraft, the CH-47 Chinooks to bring in all our heavy equipment, and for super heavy stuff, the CH-54 Sky Crane. Still a few of those around, Ericsson helicopters. and Oregon has the rights to them, and you'll see them as firefighting aircraft now. We had a lot of Cobras in other units. This is the aerial rocket artillery. We call them in when we need help. And we have other Cobras that are assigned to the units that have Hueys to escort the Hueys. And then my unit and my sister units are the cavalry. We traded in our horses for helicopters, and our mission is still the same, to go out and find the enemy. And then, in my case, I flew the Cobras and I covered the scout helicopters. General Zeist gets together with Colonel Conmee, the 3rd Brigade Commander, and says, let's do it. I want to do this operation. We take the Ashaw Valley. We choose 30 landing zones. We're only going to use 6 of them, but we don't want the enemy to know which ones we're going to use. And then the concept of operations is to take and put the 9th Marine Regiment way up in the north to catch any bad guys that may be fleeing to the north. Then take 2 Army of Vietnam, Republic of Vietnam battalions. Each battalion, by the way, is 600 to 800 soldiers. So we're going to take 2 Arvin battalions and put 1 in the north and 1 in the south. And then the main fighting force is going to be 3 more battalions from the 101st Air Mobile Division, and we're going to insert those by helicopters. And we get underway in a big way. The concept of operation that morning is that we're going to first do bombing, and we're going to do bombing for 50 minutes continuously. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of sorties bombing all those landing zones by both Navy and Air Force, and then follow that up with 18 minutes of solid artillery barrages, followed up by using the ARA helicopters to come in and prepare the LZs, followed by 1 minute for us and the cavalry to go in and do a last assessment of the landing zone before the troops land. And everybody takes off. We do the whole operation. We have sometimes formations of 65 aircraft, and nobody gets shot down. We have no casualties with the aircraft. It was one of our most successful operations ever. I'm going to concentrate on 3rd of the 187th, that's Rakasans. This was the unit I was supporting and my unit was supporting. Famous outfit, commanded by this guy, Lieutenant Colonel Weldon Honeycutt. Think about Patton and multiply times 10. This guy was about as hardcore as you're going to find. A terrific leader, a very profane man, but totally dedicated to his troops and his mission. And he's going to be in charge of this operation with this battalion. Here we're going to go into Hamburger Hill, and this is what we're faced with. See any landing zones? Not much. One of the techniques we used was to take a CH-54 sky crane, put a 10,000 pound bomb under it with a little parachute on it, and that thing sticking out the front is a proximity fuse, drop that, and it's called a daisy cutter, instant landing zone. We started bringing in the troops. There's only a 2-ship landing zone. And we dropped everybody off at 0801. We started, we finished at 0856. And then the reserves were called in at 1600 that afternoon, and he had a full complement. He had Alpha Company, Bravo Company, Charlie Company, and Delta Company. And Honeycutt says, I want to go towards that hill. That hill was called Don Abia Hill 937, which would later become Hamburger Hill. And immediately they ran into problems just trying to get up through the terrain. And then they got ambushed. We got 3 wounded that afternoon and the first of many, many medical evacuations. Day 2 got underway. All the companies were trying to fight towards Dong Abia. We're getting ambushed, taking casualties. And then the unthinkable happened. The ARA gunships mistook our troops for NVA, and we had the first of five friendly fire incidents. Lost a lot of people, a lot of casualties, more medevacs. Day three, now we're going to attack with two companies abreast and head towards Hill 937. Again, it's a tough day, and I've been out there almost continuously from morning until night. We're doing hot refueling where we never shut down the helicopter. We refuel it and we rearm it, sometimes with the helicopter still running. It's called a FART, Forward Area Rearm and Refuel Point, like a fart with a P. And you know, I've always been jealous of my Navy and Air Force counterparts. Air Force guys, you come in from Laos, drop your bombs, and then you fly back to Laos or somewhere exotic. And then your plane captain's waiting for you, puts you in an air-conditioned van, takes you to the officer's club for a chicken salad sandwich. And you Navy guys, you come over and drop your bombs, you go back to the carrier, you crash land on the carrier, your brown shirt plane captain's waiting for you, helps you off with your seatbelt, escorts you to the wardroom. You have a toasted chicken salad sandwich with sweet tea. Well, the Army thinks, oh, that's a waste of time. So they put our bullets and ammo out there just 5 minutes from the battle, and we'd land and get the aircraft sometimes rearmed and refueled and turned around in 20 minutes. We were doing that almost continuously. And this is my chicken salad sandwich. Yeah. Army guys know what that is. Horrible stuff, especially that selection, ham and eggs, unless you have something to go with it. Carried a case of that behind the seat, ate whenever we could. Day three, we're still in day three. That afternoon, my good friend Mark Stevens gets called by Weldon Honeycutt. Weldon wants a new landing zone closer to the mountain, so he sends Stevens out there with Goody Two Shoes Goodman, two Hueys, and he says, drop the engineers with their chainsaws and stuff and make me a landing zone. So Mark comes to a hover and stuff starts whizzing by the cockpit, and it's rocket propelled grenades. And he says, holy cow. He says, are those guys on the ground yet? They said, almost. He says, cut the strings. And the guys carried machetes in the Huey and chopped the strings, let the guys loose. They got out of there without getting shot down, went back, told Honeycutt, we don't have any ropes left, so we can't do the mission. Honeycutt goes, two guys show up, lots of lines and ropes. He says, get back out there, make me an LZ. He goes in the second time, sure enough, he gets shot down, goes in inverted, crashes. Now we've got more wounded on the ground. And Mark Stevens is in good shape, so he goes over to the engineer, who is, can't do anything, and is in shock, and says, show me how to use this explosive and deck cord, detonation cord. And Mark, under fire for the next 2 hours, goes around and blows up trees and makes a landing zone. And he was the pilot of the Huey, 20 years old. Day four started out at 0300 in the morning. Remember that fire base we had on the other side of the valley where all the guys got shot down? Well, that was the 6th NVA headquarters. Well, they came back. They came back at 0300 with a unit called Sappers. Sappers sneak in through heavy fortifications to try to kill you. And these guys were nude, no clothes to catch on any barbed wire. All they had was a bandana wrapped around their heads to keep the sweat out of their eyes. They made it through all the fortifications. They even took string and tied the little signal stuff that we had in the wire so they wouldn't hear them. And these guys ran through the fire base at 0300 in the morning and damn near killed everybody. We had 21 killed, 61 wounded, and 5 of our howitzers blown up. That started the day off. And then that afternoon, a Huey was coming in as we were doing medical evacuations all day. And the most dangerous thing is that they have to come to a hover and drop the strings, the hoist, to pick up He got shot down, landed on top of the troops he was trying to save, and we had more casualties that day. Day five, back trying to attack the mountain again. And I want to just talk just for a second, that loach up there, that actually was assigned to Colonel Honeycutt, and a guy named Crazy Eric Reardon was his pilot. It's not armed, it doesn't have a minigun, it can carry up to four people in it, and he was doing medical evacuations between the upper LZ and the lower LZ day and night, constantly. He was the hero of the day. Doing lots of medical evacuations. Now we're gonna try to hit the mountain again, and we get hit by friendly fire again, and also friendly gas. More people get killed and injured. We're into day seven, and it's time to take a rest. So we're not gonna attack the mountain today, but the brigade commander starts ordering in more supplies, and the corps commander even comes down to visit the troops. And Honeycutt himself has been wounded twice already, and he's ordered by the assistant commanding general to leave and get himself fixed because he's got shrapnel right next to his spine. And these are the photos that start coming out, because when this high-ranking general came in, he brought the media with him. And so we get these photos for Life magazine, Associated Press, and others. And this is Weldon Honeycutt coming back from getting surgery on his back. He was only gone a few hours and wanted to be right back with his troops. It's time to bring in another battalion, a sister battalion. They finally realize, hey, it's gonna take more troops. So we put more troops in there. Day eight, we're gonna fight it. Day nine, we do an assault. We get another friendly fire incident that actually hit Dan Bresnahan's platoon, and he's gonna talk about that next month. So we're in pretty sad shape. So now all the generals convene and say, you know, intelligence says we found the 129th NVA regiment. There are thousands of these guys dug in, and they're bringing fresh troops from across the border, which is just like a mile away. And we need some more firepower. By the way, on this day, one of my dear friends flying a loach, Bob Larson, we called him Hollywood Bob. Why do you think that is? Anyways, he took a bullet through his foot. He was helping the guys on the ground there. He was flying his little loach, took a bullet through the foot, then hit his fire extinguisher, exploded the fire extinguisher, sent shrapnel through both legs. He was able to land the helicopter in the middle of all that battle without damage. And then the ground guys came over and helped bandage his wounds, and he actually flew the helicopter back out. He went to Japan for 2 months and then insisted he come back to the unit to fly with us again. Now we're into day 10, and those on high have decided we're gonna take four battalions to attack this mountain. And we start resupplying, getting all the gear, taking out the dead and wounded, getting them all prepared to do a four battalion assault. And we do that. And this is how it looked when we began. Remember that? This is how it looks now. And we finally take the mountain on day 11. And just as we're crossing the mountain with one of the units, there's machine gun nests and bunkers up there still, and these guys feel like they're pinned down. And my buddy Len Constantine with his Cobra fires up the bunkers, kills all the bad guys, wipes out the machine guns, but these guys don't know it. So they're still hiding behind their fighting positions, and they won't proceed up to the top of the hill. Lenny lands his Cobra on the ground, facing the bunkers, opens the door, and waves the ground troops forward. He just retired from Continental as a 777 captain. So the guys occupy the hill, and this is when Ed Henry posts the infamous sign on the mountain. Of course, all this is going back to the United States. Ted Kennedy said attacking the hill 11 times with troops and all these casualties is insane. Nixon calls General Abrams, says, don't let this happen again. No more big operations. No more American casualties like this. Let's start the peace process right away, which we didn't know was secret. And let's start working on Vietnamization, letting the Vietnamese, the South Vietnamese, take over the battle. So a year later, we did the largest helicopter operation in history, but no U.S. ground troops. Congress had passed a law that we couldn't go into Laos or Cambodia at all. But air crews could, so U.S. helicopter pilots were tasked with taking Marvin battalions into Laos to fight these guys. And they were waiting for us. They shot down 168 helicopters and damaged 618. And then the peace treaty was signed in 73. We started bringing the POWs home. And one last chance for our good old helicopter pilots, Operation Frequent Wind, when we did the largest humanitarian evacuation in history. We had evacuated over 7,000 people by helicopters to aircraft carriers that were off the coast. And fixed wing evacuated over 50,000 out of Tonsonut, including 2,768 orphans. So it was our last chance to save lives. One of my friends was actually the helicopter coordinator on the carrier. He said they had a volunteer Vietnamese pilot take the flyable aircraft, go fly them over the ocean, drop them into the ocean, and then climb out and swim, and they would pick him up, and he did that again and again and again. Same guy. And our last flight, the iconic photo with the Air America aircraft. And we lost Saigon 1975. I flew 726 missions. This is my Hollywood shot. This is what I really looked like. I was down to 138 pounds. Thank you very much, everybody. Sorry, it's kind of a grim subject, but that's not the way it is. Thank you. And I have books in the back that'll tell you a lot more. Thank you. And one last comment, that's why I love helicopter pilots. Every talk I give, I end with this. Helicopter pilots will try to save a life every chance they get. Hooray for you guys that still fly rotary wing. I love you. Thank you.